Well, hello. Number one, it's great that everybody came back. I remember in 2010 when we held the coaching summit in Toronto, and the women's portion came on just after lunch, and most of the decision makers didn't come for the presentation. So it's great that, number one, you came back. Just a little bit on my background in case you're wondering what I do or who I am. Title, obviously, General Manager of the National Women's Programs for Hockey Canada. I've been involved in our women's program since 1992. And I have coached all ages. On the men's side, I've coached from 5 years old up to junior A. And on the women's side, 5 years right up to our Olympic team. So I've actually coached more men than I've coached women. And on any given day, I can't stand either gender. So we're pretty safe there on that piece. I was asked, there's been a lot of talks about leadership, and that was the theme I'm supposed to go on. I'm going to stay on that. I'm going to throw in different pieces around women's hockey and women's sport. It's been a long road for me, and just even getting me up here, or getting a woman up here on the stage to speak to all of you has been a long road as well. First off, I'd like to acknowledge the women in the crowd, because I know how hard it is to come to a seminar where there's only three or four of you. So could the women in the crowd please stand up? It's not very many of you. Stand up. Be proud of that. Stand up. It's a hard go, and I can be honest, when I walked in here, I was pretty disheartened, and I saw only four women, and I... If I go back 25, 30 years ago when I first started coming to seminars like this, there was the same amount of women. And to think that we're only still at this stage is a bit discouraging, to be honest with you. But I'll see if I can convert some of you over to the side, or at least giving some pushes within your own organizations or federations to help us out. So we've heard all weekend about success. What is success? What does that how do you define it? That has to be for whatever you're doing. Success is whatever you are. Success for me this weekend will be if some of you walk out of here going, hey, I can do something in my club or in my federation for women's hockey. And I know I can do that. Or if you walk out of here and say, hey, I'm on the right track. I'm doing these things now. And I think for me, that would be success here. But every day, your definition of success is different. And what that means for you in your personal life or your sport life is up to you. But you should have a definition of what that means. Every morning when you wake up, how am I going to define myself today? What's that going to look like? If you don't do that, then you're just going to flounder around all day and feel like you've accomplished nothing throughout the day. Just taking a look here just to make sure we're all on the same page, and I'm not sure how many people have known this or know this, but five cycles that we've been in the Olympic Winter Games. There you see the gold, silver, bronze. It hasn't changed a lot. But you know what? That's not the women in the games' fault. That's the decision makers above them. That's the ones who allocate the money. That's the one who decides what kind of ice time you get. To be able to grow the sport and grow the game, we need everybody involved, and whether it's men's or women's hockey. So if I go to the last World Championships that we just had in Plymouth, Michigan, Germany came in first time back in a while at the top division, and went right up into the quarterfinals, into the semis, and played for a medal. They didn't even qualify for the Olympics going into Pyeongchang now. Czech Republic had a great tournament as well. They didn't qualify for the Olympics. So the parity in the women's game, yes, you can say Canada and the U.S. are strong. You can say Finland's probably in a league of its own with that, and then Sweden's pushing on the door, Russia. But there's great parity in the game. And it's only being stunted by people above it in terms of decision-making and people around it who don't want to grow it or don't want to see it grow. So just a quick note on that. The ingredients of a team, I think everybody's gone through this, player selection, technical, tactical, team building, staff, energy levels, creating a performance bubble, adversity as a springboard. These are all separate presentations. You could do an hour-long talk on each presentation, but the one thing, and it's been echoed throughout the last day and a half, is that everyone wants to be successful until they see what it actually takes, and that's hard work. And that's communication. It's a number of pieces. None of these areas are going to matter if you can't deliver on the leadership piece. And what leadership looks like for you, again, is defined by wherever you're at. Thought this was great. You can do this. You could say this is a coach's mind. You could say whatever. But how many distractions do we have? How many things we got going on in our lives? I know I've sat here for the last day and a half thinking I should be 20 other places but here. And I have a million other things to do but do this presentation. But the distractions and the things and how we focus and how we dial in comes to our leadership styles. It comes to our ability to plan and prepare and get ready for what's up next. And if we aren't planning and we don't have some vision, then we're going to be all over the place. That's what we're going to look like. That's what we're going to look like to our players. That's what we're going to look like to our owners, to our management, everything. Championship habits are hard. I've been involved in 4 Olympic gold medals, 3 as a coach, 1 as an assistant, 2 as a head, and 1 as the GM. None of them are the same. None of the stories are the same. None of the challenges we had are the same. The path we took is relatively the same. But man, the differences and the changes we went through for every one of those medals is unbelievable. And it all comes down to habits. And it's hard. You can take any system you want. You can teach anything you want. But if you don't have habits on the ice, if you don't have habits off the ice, if you don't have personal habits yourself, it's hard. Really hard. And to be able to teach that and model it and be consistent in it is extremely hard. And that's life or sport. And that's up to us. If we're going to take on players, regardless of how old they are, if they're 5 years old or 45 years old, we're all about life and we're about sport. And the habit part is exhausting, incredibly exhausting. I think the organizing committee here has done a great job keeping everybody on track, getting you fed, coffee, in on time. Those bells are hilarious. I think that's great. The whistle that was used yesterday as well. But that's all about habits. Somebody mentioned, I think, today about being on time. I think Tommy mentioned that, being on time. We've had coaches before that walk into my office and complain that the athletes aren't on time. And when I start watching what's happening, they're showing up 15 minutes late for every meeting. Well, if you're showing up 15 minutes late for a meeting, your players are going to show up 20 minutes after because they don't want to sit around and wait for you to show up. So the habit piece is really tough. Why bother? Tom started it right away yesterday. Why do you coach? Why do you coach? Why do you put yourself through the shit? Like, it's hard. Like, some mornings I wake up and I'm just like, seriously, could I just have a real job? Could I just go 9 to 5 and go home and not have any responsibilities and nobody has a crisis at 5:05 and all of those things? But why? I can tell you, for me, I grew up in a small town in Alberta, Canada. 1,000 people, no street lights, no public transportation, nothing. And we played every sport. We coached all the sports. But we didn't know, the people who were my coaches and who led me as a young athlete, they didn't know what was out there. They didn't know what was in the province. They didn't know what was in the country. They didn't know how to take us as young athletes to another level or even offer that up. And I always swore that if I ever got in the opportunity, or got in a position, I was going to make sure that young people in rural areas or small areas knew what was out there. Because there's great athletes that we don't even see. So that was why I initially started coaching. That and my mom made me. So those two reasons were the reasons that I started. Not a word of lie. I went to, on the hockey side, I started coaching hockey in grade 8, and I started coaching my brother's team. I don't know why or how I ended up out there. I feel like I was that kid up against the glass like this, and the dads just got tired of watching me there and felt sorry for me and brought me on the ice because then girls didn't play hockey. There was no girls' hockey team. And for anybody that knows me, if you open the door and I want to go through it, I'm going through it and I'm not leaving it. And that's exactly what happened. I got on the ice with my brother's team and I stayed with him right through to I graduated from high school and he would have been in grade 7 or 8 at the time. Then the following year, I come home in the summertime and I go to with my mom to minor ball registration and they ask her to coach and she says no, but she will. And of course, I'm a 19-year-old spoiled brat and I'm like, what? I'm not doing that. Like, it's my summer. I want to have fun. She's like, you're coaching. And I coached them for 6 years until they left school. And that's why I coached, was to get back into it, to give back and get girls going. Then as I got a bit older and got involved at a higher level in hockey, I realized that not every female, not every woman had the opportunities I had. I was incredibly fortunate growing up in Alberta with all of the hockey men around me, the Wayne Flemings, the Dave Kings, the Tom Rennies, Mike Johnsons. You can go on and on about the men that were around me. And you know what? They never told me I didn't belong. They never told me I couldn't come. Sometimes they didn't talk to me, but they never told me I couldn't be there. And the fathers I coached with on my brother's team, they never told me that women didn't do this. And when I got older and I got in our national program and I started to listen to other females or other women in our country talk about the obstacles they had, I was just like, whoa, glad that's not me. But then it became an obligation. It became a responsibility I had to the game, to myself, to women, to you as men, to open minds and open doors and make sure that other people who come along behind me, it doesn't matter if you're men or women, that they understand that it is a game and we have a responsibility to give back to it in whatever manner that is. Not just because you're a woman or not just because you're a pro player that wants to coach, but you have a responsibility if you're in the game to give back to it. So it became more about this. Sound?
Too pretty to play basketball.
Dad told me I couldn't be a boxer. He said I was too small.
There was a guy who tried to spit on me and then push me out of his way.
There comes a point where you have to be sure of yourself. People aren't used to women being so passionate. It scares them.
One day I just said it doesn't matter what other people think.
I'm a fashion model who can dunk.
I'm a girl. That doesn't mean I have to wear a skirt.
Doesn't mean I can't get all fired up. They used to say that girl is crazy.
But then I just kept winning. Somebody's got to be the best. So why not me?
I'm 55 years old and I run close to 70 miles a week.
I never felt like quitting.
There's something telling me to do it every single day. My one true love. It's my life.
I'm sure every one of you has a mom, I hope, has a mom. A daughter, a granddaughter, a sister. All of those types of people in your life, those are the reasons that you want to think about what you could do in women's sport. And in Canada, with our Olympic prep, we play in a midget AAA boys league. We play right in the league in our full-time year. And in that year, we play against, I think, 18 teams, 30 games. And I like to think that every time we play against one of those teams, those 20 boys or young men leave and they're a little bit better because they played against us. And I always used to think that. I didn't know if it was right or not. But when I moved into junior A coaching and I started to coach there, there's always a process I had to go through as a coach, as a female. And you sort of went through it over the first month, and then eventually everybody accepted you, and away you went with a male team. And with this particular junior team, I didn't have to go through the process. Like, they were listening to me. There seemed to be a bit of respect already. I was confused because that's not the way it worked. I come in as a female, and you figure out whether you like me or whether you want me to coach you or not, and then we get to a good point, and away we go, we have a fun season. So I said to the guys one time in the dressing room, I said, I don't get it, like, you know, I explained to them my process and how it worked, and the one guy started laughing, and I was like, Jack, what are you laughing at? And he goes, Jesus, Mel, your team's kicked the shit out of us for the last 2 years in midget. He says, we don't need to worry about whether we're going to respect you or not, we just want you to teach us what you taught them. And, you know, that just reinforced what I was thinking there in terms of the impact we could have. The next thing you got to do as a leader is you got to say, what if? What if we did this? You know, what if there was women's hockey? What if we took our team on a retreat? What if? And you have to look at that, and you got to go off the wall on it sometimes. Sometimes the biggest team chemistry pieces are the most wild ideas you have, and your team does it, and that bonds them and gives them a starting point that you could never create on the ice. But it gives you success. So what if? Being able to write all those ideas down. Aku knows, what if Mel Davidson presented at this conference? It's taken 5 years for Mel Davidson to be on this stage. But what if? What if that happens? So you've got to ask yourself that. You have to have vision. You've got to look into vision. Or you have to look into the future. And to do that, you have to have experience. If you don't have the experience, you have to draw on your life experience in terms of what's been going on and use the people who have come before you. Listen to them. There's so much on the internet now that you can research and take a look at, but you have to have some experience if you're going to have vision. The Australian plan that was just put up there, that doesn't come just out of somebody's head. That comes from experience. That comes from looking at reality and what's happening. And really, you're making dreams reality. That's what you're doing as a coach. Whatever that dream might be. to score that first goal, to play in the Olympics, to play in the NHL, to play in Division I, whatever it might be, you're making dreams reality. And in women's hockey, the national team is the NHL. That's the NHL. The Olympics is our Stanley Cup or our league, our Division I championship. And when we cut the players from our teams, we've just taken away their dreams because there's no place else for them to go. We just went through this with our Olympic roster here just the last 3 weeks. Four players we released, there's no place else for them to go. And two of them said that to me. Mel, what do I do now? Where do I play? I would suggest with men it's similar, but you have a lot more options. But you're making dreams reality as a leader. What will they remember? I think that's the biggest thing. How many of you played the game? How many of you in the crowd played the game? Put your hands up. You know, it's funny, as coaches, we want everybody to answer questions, but we're too shy to even put our hands up, right? So most people here have played the game. Like, is the first thing that come out of your mouth, like, man, Tom, he was the best penalty kill coach I ever had? No. Was he the best power? No, it's the type of person they are. So what are they going to remember about your time there? This was our crew here. In the early years, you used to be able to carry your skates on the plane so that you didn't have to worry if your equipment didn't show up. Then after 911, you can bring your skates on the plane, and now there's some airlines that let you bring your skates on the plane. So this group has never grown up in a generation where they could bring their skates on the plane. And I forget where we were going. I think when Sweden hosted the World Championships, we wanted them to bring their skates on the plane just to make sure, because we were tight on our turnaround and everything. Well, you would have thought we asked them to give up their firstborn. Really? We got to bring our skates on the plane? We got to carry them around? So instead, they brought them. But this was their piece here. They enticed the flight attendant to pretend that they were going to walk on the plane with their skates on. And they remember all of this. I never planned that. I just want them to bring their skates on the damn plane. They didn't want to bring their skates, so now they're making a point, but everybody was happy. But at the same time, they still talk about this. And those are moments that you can't even create. I would have never believed it went that far. But what will they remember about you? What are they going to say about you? If they give your eulogy, what are they going to say about you? And I guarantee you it's not going to be, oh, they had the best penalty kill or the best forecheck. It's going to be something else. So what are they going to remember? This is so true for me. I'm so glad I grew up in the 80s and 90s. I said and did so much stupid shit, and there's no record of it anywhere. You know? How many? Yeah, we all did that, right? But do you know what it's like out there? Are you connected through social media? Do you have a good sense of the challenges and pressures? I don't think I'd want to be a teenager these days. The stress on them, a young adult. There's so many. I don't remember any of that. Heck, I didn't figure out I was going to university until April of my grade 12 year, and only because mom and dad told me I had to go. So, I mean, do we know what it's like out there? Do you know what the challenges are? Do you know when they walk into your arena or into your dressing room, do you know where they just came from? Do you know what's going on with their family, with their marital situation, with their kids? Making sure all of those pieces that you have a connection there with them. That's how they started. This is my niece and nephew. They hate me every time I put this up there. They're 30 now and they have their own kids. But this is where they start. Passion, enthusiasm, generally a pretty good work ethic. Kids don't come with no work ethic. They learn that from their adults. And all of that make a difference. So this is where they started at some point. It's your job to make sure they maintain that through their whole career. Maybe if they lose it and they come to you and they don't have it, it's your job to get them back to this, to get them back to those smiles and those laughs and the reason they're playing the game. Failing versus giving up. Dr. Claire Drake from the University of Alberta, a number of you would remember that name, when he spoke, he always talked about you could paint a zebra black, but eventually the stripes show through. So there was a lot of talk through Tommy's presentation about positive, negative. I would suggest you have to figure out who your zebras are. Who are your zebras? Because you can't have very many of them on your team. That's number one. Number two, you have to teach players to fail, not to give up. So they can't look at it like, well, I can't achieve that, so I'm just not even going to try. They got to try, and they got to learn to fail, and they have to learn to pick themselves up and see what that felt like and what they can do to correct that and make it better. So the two pieces there, teaching your athletes to fail, not give up, And be aware of the zebras, because they'll kill you every time. The energy takers, you'll spend so much time with them that the good ones and the good people, the ones that can really use you, you're not going to spend enough time with them. Be careful of the zebras. And team building, or any type of thing where you got your people together, that teaches you who your zebras are. We have a three-week boot camp coming up with our senior women's team. I can tell you we're going to have a lot of zebras through that week. And it's not about cutting them or criticizing them. It's helping them realize when they're zebras and then figuring out as a coach, is that correctable? And they have a method by which to get by that. Or that just is a quality they have in them that we can't fix. And I don't know if we want them in our program or on our team. There's more than hockey in their life and in your life. These are my great nephews. Obviously, they're going somewhere. I don't know where, dressed like that. But there's more than hockey in their life. If you teach young kids, how many of you teach young kids, sort of under 18? Under 18s. Lots, right? I guarantee you they have not thought about practice until they step on the ice. You've been planning practice all day. You might have had a plan for a month. But when they step on that ice, they haven't thought about it. And how many of us get mad at them because they're not ready to practice? Got a 10-year-old, you're not ready to practice. What do you mean you're not ready to practice? Well, they have other things in their life. You have other things in your life. And on that same note, when you come into something, you have to be ready to give them 100%. We don't have the opportunity as leaders to say, oh, I had so much stuff going on in my life today, I just can't be good for you today. I got to be good. And if I can't be good, I got to take the back seat. My assistant coaches have to be good today. This is a great one, eh? School playground equipment in the year 1900. Apparently in 1900, only the strong survived recess. Like, imagine if we put our kids in here, like we'd all be in jail, right? You know? But the balance between experience and new methods. Somebody mentioned here in the last day and a half, you coach how you were coached. And that can be great or it can be dangerous. So make sure that you have a balance. What's happening out there? And for us in the women's game, nobody wanders into our area and starts talking to us about anything. We got to go out and find it. We got to go out and call people up. I would say some of you need to do that as well. But make sure if you're coaching how you were coached, it's because it's relevant and needed right then and there. If you're not, if you're coaching how you were coached and it's old school or it's not there anymore, then you need to take a look at what's actually happening out there and what are the new methods. In Canada, I hear this a lot. In North America, my daughter is just like a boy. In some countries, I might hear, I don't want my daughter to be just like a boy. This is what it looks like for us. I know there's challenges for guys, too. I know that. But this is truly what it looks like for us. I have a permanent concussion on my head from banging it on the glass ceiling in terms of everything that we have to go through, we have to do. I don't want you to feel sorry for me for that. But I want you to understand that if you're here and you're associated with a women's program, you should have a female coach or a female leader right here with you. You should have encouraged her and brought her here. Because you know what? We don't do things real well. When I did my level four, coaching in Canada with Mike Babcock, Todd McCullen, Alain Vigneault, all of those guys in the NHL. I did all of that. And I did almost 5 years with them. We went to a number of summer seminars together. We were group leaders together. And I'd go to all the classes and all the courses. I'd go back to my room later. That's what I did for 4 or 5 different times, summers. So 1 year we were group leaders together in Saskatoon. And they asked me to go out with them. Mel, we're going for coffee. Do you want to come? Ooh, yeah. Never been for coffee with them before. That's so exciting. So then we get to coffee, and we're talking about the forecheck, and they get out the salt and pepper shakers, just like you hear about, and they're just like, well, Mel, they're talking through their forechecks, and they go, well, Mel, what do you want? What do you do? And they put it in front of me, and I froze. I froze. I didn't have an answer. And I was so mad at myself. So the next morning at breakfast, we're sitting at the table, getting ready for the day with our groups, and I go, wait, I got to tell you guys something. They're like, sure, what, Mel? They're like, you know, last night when you asked me about the forecheck? Yeah. They're like, well, I have an answer. And one guy, of course, goes, it took you that long? And I was like, no, I had an answer, but you guys have never asked me out before. So I was so excited I got to go out with you. And then when you asked my opinion, like, this was 4 or 5 years we've been together. Like, I just overwhelmed me. And they're just looking at me. And you know what I learned that day, women, ladies, and gentlemen, this will help you guys too, hopefully, is when you're a guy, you don't need an invitation. Like, if you're all going to the game, everybody's going to the game. If we're going to the bar, you go to the bar. We need invitations. We have to be invited before we intrude on your time. And I learned really quickly that day that if the guys say, hey, we're going to Jimmy's Pub tomorrow, I can go to Jimmy's Pub too. I don't have to have an invitation. But women do need an invitation. So if you're sitting here and saying, well, we got five female coaches. They never said they wanted to come to the symposium. Did you invite them? If you didn't invite them, that's why they're not here. So these are the things you can do there.
Good job, guys.
Treasure these moments for the rest of your life with your basketball.
Never stop fighting together and fighting for each other.
First of all, I had the misfortune and the good fortune of being a head coach at 24 years of age. So the misfortune is I didn't work under enough people and gain enough knowledge. The good fortune is I was in my own laboratory working on things. Nobody cared because we only averaged about 400 people coming to the games. No one could tell me that I was making mistakes or not. I've had a manager of my team become a head coach in the pros in Frank Vogel. I had a grad assistant coach two NBA teams in Jeff Van Gundy. I've had a captain at Boston University become the head coach of the Philadelphia 76ers. I had a player in Rick Carlisle become the head coach of the Dallas Mavericks. Brett Brown becoming the head coach of the 76ers. And then I had 25 assistant coaches in college go on to be head coaches. I've had players like Travis Ford, John Pelfrey, and Billy Donovan move on, to name a few. So I've had a crowded bridge. And when you have a crowded bridge, because you build a bridge for people to cross over, and when your bridge is crowded, that's your legacy. They help you build the bridge, you help them cross over.
I have four Olympic gold medals, but the proudest thing I ever feel is when one of my former players says, Mel, I want to coach, or what should I do? Or I see them coaching, and I would suggest that you should all strive to have a crowded bridge and have both males and females in it. Every decision has an impact. The toughest thing we have to do is make decisions. We have five world-class goaltenders in our program, five. Every one of them could start in any other country as the starting goalie in an Olympic gold medal game. We had to let two of them go. Every decision has an impact. Where they go, what they do, so important. And there's no straight roads. But you have to have, we go right back to that vision slide, the plane, the vision, and making dreams reality. You have to know your vision so you know what your decision impacts in the end. It can't just be a reaction decision. Be comfortable being uncomfortable. Love this one. When I get old, my dad, I'm sure, says this. When I get old, I'm going to move in with my kids, hog the computer, pay no bills, eat all the food, trash the house, and when asked to clean, pitch a fit like it's killing me. For sure. For sure. You have to be uncomfortable being uncomfortable. For some of you, it might be uncomfortable that there's a woman up here talking about hockey, and that's fine. But you have to be comfortable with that. Some of the decisions that you're going to have to make are going to suck, and you're going to feel like crap afterwards. But you have to be comfortable with that. I asked a couple of guys that coach in the NHL now. In 2010, I asked two of them whether they'd be my assistant coach at Vancouver. And both of their responses were, Mel, the first time they sat down at my desk and started crying because they weren't on the power play, that'd be it. I'd be done. I'd be handing them the power play. I'd be saying, you're on the power play. Go. They couldn't be comfortable being uncomfortable in that environment. And that's a fair comment. And I've had guys cry too, so I'm just using, but I'm using what they use as an example. So I think that's important there. Under pressure, your performance will sink to the level of your preparation. So however your team plays is determined by your preparation. Whatever you performed, that's where it is. And a great example I had, young coach coaching ball, had a great ball team, supposed to win Alberta Provincials, We're up whatever in the semifinal game and just needed to get out of the bottom half of the fifth, and we have we're going to the gold medal game. Well, we implode and we lose the game in nine. And I was so mad and I'm yelling at those girls because they should have won and what were they doing and just using some few choice words. When I was done, my mom grabbed me by my ear or my hair, I can't remember. I do remember part of my head being grabbed. Drug me to our station wagon, because that's what we had as a family, and went up one side of me and down another and said, don't you ever talk to people like that again, and if they weren't ready, that's your fault. That's not their fault. And I've never forgotten that. I've never forgotten that. So don't be upset by the results you didn't get with the work you didn't do. If you didn't do the work as a coach and you didn't get them ready, then you're going to get the type of results that you may not like. Repetition breeds sense. We've seen this a lot. We hear it a lot nowadays. There's no common sense. There's no hockey sense. All of those things. Repetition breeds sense. If kids aren't getting repetition by play or separately like they used to, then we have to create an environment for that. We have to be able to help build common sense. And if we go back to the slide in the 1900s in the playground, that probably built a lot of common sense, hey? If you're going to fall off that, it's going to hurt. So maybe I'm going to be a little bit more careful there. But we have to help build that. We have to help create an environment to do that. If that means we got 90 minutes ice time and we're going to leave 15 minutes just for them to play, depending on the age or the what we want to accomplish, we have to be able to create that environment. The athletes, the players have patience, do you? This is a perfect one here. A child learns to walk and falls down 50 times. He never thinks to himself, maybe this isn't for me. Maybe I just won't learn to walk. You're going to learn to walk at some point, right? So they have the patience. It's usually us as coaches that don't have the patience. We want to jump too far ahead. And I always say to my coaches that I work with, if they come off the ice and the drill was awful or something went wrong, and they're like, all right, and they're complaining about the players because that's the first thing we do as coaches, always say to them, if the drill was too complicated or they couldn't get it, that's your fault. That means somewhere in the middle you've missed something, whether it's skills, technical, or whether it's a tactical piece. Teach solutions. This piece here I think is great. My players could complain as much as they wanted to as long as they had a solution at the end of the complaint. So you couldn't just walk in the office and unload on me and walk out. You could unload, but you had to have a solution. And the best is when teams are complaining. And you know what? We let officials take over our lives completely. How much do we complain about the refereeing or the officials? I hear it all the time. I talk to any member of my family at the NHL playoffs. The first thing they do is complain about the officiating. But as soon as you start complaining, you're focused on something else and people are going to beat you or be more successful than you. Facebook crashed, so I spent some time with my family today. They seem like nice people. That could be any type of social media. Be visible, be engaged. We heard lots on communication already, but be visible and be engaged. You can't just walk out of your office door and step on the ice and expect people to buy in or expect people to be with you. You have to be visible and you have to be engaged. There has to be a line there. There's a difference between being friends and being friendly, and you have to respect that line. Moments matter. Huge believer in this. When milk is splattered all over the floor and those little eyes are looking at you for your reaction, remember what really matters. It takes 5 minutes to clean up spilled milk. It takes much longer to clean up a broken spirit. And we've all had them. We've all had those kids that have come to us and their spirit's been broken. It might have been from home. It might not have had anything to do with coaches. But we have a responsibility to make sure that we send them away with a full spirit and that same passion and enthusiasm that you saw of my niece and nephew when they were fooling around as young kids. Teach athletes to talk nicely. How many have been here? When mom calls you by your full name. Like when my mom goes, Melody, I know I'm in trouble. Even on the phone, right? I know it, right? But you have to, how many of us don't talk nicely to ourselves? I would say a lot of us. Right? But we have to teach athletes to talk nicely to ourselves. Didn't take me very long to figure out that whatever I said in the post-game speech ended up in the media. So if I beat our players up in the post-game speech, that's exactly what went out in the media. So I learned pretty quickly to make sure that whatever I wanted to be in the media is what I said in the dressing room, and I saved anything for less or later. But we have to start talking. And these days, with everything around mental well-being and all the pressures on people nowadays at all ages, we have to be better to ourselves. We have to talk nicer to ourselves. The size and quality of your network matters. This was 3/4 of our group when we started this quad in the summer of 2014. I'm probably missing about 40 people there. But this network here is huge. There's people here that I haven't seen for years. And it's incredible, the hockey family, the hockey world, but the network matters. And people are more than willing to talk hockey and to talk shop. You'd be amazed at the conversations and communications you can have. But this matters almost more than anything else for you as a leader. It is leadership. It's about a decision. Decision making, you have to make them. It's an obligation. If you decide to be a coach, you've decided you're going to be a leader, you have to step up. It's hard work, so you have to get tough sometimes. And it's a community. Connect. We've all been there. Most of us have been fired. Most of us have been hired. We've all been in those shoes. And if you haven't been fired, you will be, and people have been through it. And the last one I put on my own, leadership is lonely. Sometimes you have to laugh. Leadership is lonely.
You think you know me? You know the conviction and determination I need every day. The years of training, pushing myself to be the strongest, the sharpest. My dedication to the game, to my teammates who are counting on me to deliver. The nerves of steel, the preparation and ritual before the adrenaline of the match. The responsibility of being my best every time, prepared to fight every shift on the ice. This is not just a sport. This is who I am.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life. Prove I'm alright song. My power is turned on. Starting right now, I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes. Cause I've still got a lot of fight left in me. Losing friends and I'm chasing sleep. Everybody's worried.
It takes a village for the game. It takes a village to raise kids. It takes a village to coach them. Hopefully, if you weren't, if you didn't get anything out of what I just talked about, hopefully you're entertained in one capacity or another. We need you. We need you to help us in the women's game. You need us in this world for the game itself. And hopefully, we can continue to build it. You saw there, those were the countries that were at the top division at the Women's Worlds and where they sit. And that, and all of us have a responsibility. I have a responsibility to help the men's game. You have a responsibility to help our game. It takes a village. Thank you very much for hearing me.